Okay, so we saw a number of inequalities last time. We'll see a few more generalizations as we go along. So, but today I will start with the notion of a metric space. Basically, we'll define this notion and see a lot of examples with the aid of the various inequalities that we prove. So, what is a metric space? Space for us is a general collection of points. Okay. Metric is some metric on that. It's something that measures something. What does it measure? Well, generally we do problems where we try to approximate things, then we would like to look at the error, and then when we want to look at the error, how do you quantify that error? Then I want to say that my guess that I have done is very close to what it should be. So what do you mean by very close to? So that concept of being very close to has to be properly quantified. So one of the ways to quantify the fact that something is close to this is to say that the distance between these two is very small. Okay. So the important concept is the notion of a distance. And that abstract concept introduced anywhere is called a metric. So let us first look at on the real line for real numbers, if x and y are any two real numbers, say we may have this situation, x here, y there, or we may have y here and x there, or it may happen that both x and y are same. So when you take any two real numbers x and y, how do we measure the distance between these two? The standard measure is to look at y minus x here, here x minus y, which simply means look at the difference and take the absolute value. And here x minus x is 0, therefore that is it. So we define distance from x to y as dxy equal to the absolute value of x minus y. Now, what we observe is that the distance being the absolute value is always greater than or equal to 0, and that becomes 0 only when the two points collapse into the same thing. Otherwise, there is a strict positive distance. Equal to 0 if and only if x equal to y. The second property we look at is whether you look at the distance from x to y or y to x, it is the same. So that is a symmetry. Dxy is equal to dyx. The third property is most of the time difficult to verify, but in this case very easy. Instead of going from x to y, if I had gone to some other point z and then gone to y, that z can be here, here or there. In any way, you are wandering too much. Therefore, the total distance traveled will be much more than going directly. So this is called the triangle inequality. Dxy is less than or equal to dxz plus dyz. So let me then, where all cases, all these are in, right? So these are some very simple observations, and these are the crucial properties of the distance which give us almost everything that we do in analysis. Okay. Now what we do is we want to generalize this. Okay, so we now generalize. How do we generalize this? First of all, in place of R, we start with an arbitrary non-empty set. So let X be any non-empty set. Okay. Now, whenever we talk about distance, we talk about the distance between two points. Okay. So it's something that depends on two points, and therefore it is something to do with x cross y, x cross x. So the distance is a function from x cross x to the real number, such that all these properties are satisfied. That is, the distance is always greater than or equal to 0, equal to 0 if and only if x equal to y. 2, it is symmetric. 3, it satisfies that wandering distance is more. Rho xy is less than or equal to rho xz plus rho zy. This is for every x, y, z belonging to x. So, rho is an assignment which assigns for every pair some number. For every pair x, y, it assigns a number. That number must be non-negative, must become 0 only in the two elements coincide, and it is symmetric. If the pair is written the other way around also, you get the same value and satisfies what is known as the triangle. This is usually known as triangle inequality. Obvious reasons. Okay. Yeah. Doesn't matter. Yeah, yeah. You could as well say it R plus. Yeah, right. Yes, we will see. Okay. We will see at least one. Right. When we see examples, that we will see at least one metric on any arbitrary set. There will be many metrics. And then we will see that if you know one metric, there are many metrics, and so on and so forth. Okay. So then we say, rho is a metric on the set X, and X together with the metric rho is called a metric space. Written as X rho. Okay. So the metric space is a package deal. Again, there is a carrier set X and this distance concept. We may retain the same carrier set, may change the distance concept. Then as a set it is the same, but as metric spaces that will be different. You will see lots of examples like that. Okay. What we should do is, we should look at some examples. First thing is to get a collection of metric spaces, examples, standard ones, and then whenever we have some theorem or something, we would like to see how does it look in this situation, so on and so forth. Okay. Now, so we will spend now quite a bit of time on examples. Pardon me? I have just now answered his question. Right? right? What did I answer to him? He said, how do I know there is a metric on an arbitrary set? I said, I will show you. There is at least one metric on every set. Okay. But however, that does not mean anything. Okay. The question is, do we have a right on the right set that we are interested in certain right metrics? That is all. It is not a question of, are there no metric spaces. Yeah, there are topological spaces. There are topologies which are not generated by metrics. But we are interested in the particular concept of where such a distance is defined. Okay? And we are going to look at those situations. Right. So the first example, of course, is the fellow who motivated us to this. The real numbers with that distance. So we will call that D. So R D as defined above is this distance concept in the real numbers is called the usual metric on R. Okay, this D is called the usual metric. So let's look at an arbitrary set. Let X be any set. Of course, any non-empty set. We always look at non-empty sets because there is nothing there, so let's not waste our time with that. Let X be any non-empty set. Okay. So now we are going to define a distance as follows. Define a metric. A metric on X as follows. Now, what do we want to do? We want to take two points and say what is the distance. Okay. Now, clearly we want the two points are the same, the distance must be 0. So, we will have to define rho of xy to be 0. If x, y, because we have to define that way. Whenever x equal to y, we need the distance to be 0. And that is the only occasion when it should be 0. So, for x not equal to y, it should be a non-zero thing. So, what I will do is, I will define it 1. See, it is like a society where everybody wants to keep a distance from the other fellow. Everybody at a distance one mile away from the other chap. Nobody wants to talk to the other guy. Okay. And that is why this is called a discrete. This is easy to verify that this is a metric. Okay. I'll leave it to you to verify those three conditions, which is almost trivial. Okay. Easy. Metric. This is called on X. X, therefore, on the metric space with one metric at least. It will not be very interesting. Example sometimes, but may not be a very useful when we don't analyze, you may not use it much, okay. But they will use it for producing a few examples. Okay, so that's the second example. There now, at least on every set, we can define at least one metric. Now, therefore, for example, on R, I can take the discrete metric. So now that becomes a different metric space altogether, even though it is R. So in particular, for example, let X be or to the discrete metric. Is a metric space. Okay. What shall we name this discrete metric? Okay, we'll call this as rho discrete. I mean, put a capital D, rho discrete. So R D is our rho D. Is as a metric space is different from the metric space or that D we had, the usual metric. The carrier set is the same. We are dealing with the real numbers only. We are using different concepts of distance. Let's get out of some of the simpler examples first. So now from R we move to R2. Then we'll straight away go to Rn and Cn. So this is example 4. Let us take the set X to be 2. What is R2? All those points in the plane. So these all vectors x1, x2, such that x1, x2 belong to R. So now if you take 2 points in this set, so x and y belong to R2. So basically geometrically what do you see here? X is a point here and y is a point here. Okay. So there are 2 points in the plane, basically geometrically. X, y belong to R2 means there are 2 points in the plane. Now, we already have a notion of in our PUC or whatever it is, high school, I do not know when they learned this year. Many things I learnt in MSc or now learnt in high school. Okay, so anyway, we real a formula for the distance between 2 points. We never say that that is a very particular distance. Okay. What is remember, the distance between 2 points? Square root of x1 minus y1 squared plus x2 minus y2 squared. What they mean is really the length of the line segment joining those 2 points. And because they call it the distance, as though that is the only distance. Okay. But we will take it as the usual distance. Okay. So we will call it the metric is defined as, we are assuming, okay, rho of xy is square root of x1 minus y1 squared plus x2 minus y2 squared. Again, the square root is non-negative square root. Now, I will call this distance as rho 2. Okay. We will see why we use that notation. I call that distance as rho 2 as you would do optimally, whatever optimally means. Okay. In the sense of Euclid, the shortest distance between x and y, whatever language you want to use it, analytically this is what it means. Now, you can verify all the axioms of the metric. Let us do it, okay, at least once. First of all, note, rho 2 xy is greater than or equal to 0 because the non-negative square, non-negative quantities, everything is negative. And when is it 0? This must be 0. That means x1 must be equal to y1, x2 must be equal to y2. That is the point x must be equal to y. No problem about the non-negativity part. Symmetry part is obvious because it's a square. X1 minus Y1 square is the same as Y1 minus X1 square and so on. So clearly, rho 2 XY is equal to rho 2 YX for every XY in R. In all these cases I mentioned above, the only non-trivial thing is the triangle inequality. Now this is the reason why it is called triangle. Now you can see, suppose there is a point Z, instead of going from X to Y and distance I wanted to Z and Y, then what will be the total distance? XZ plus ZY, and we know all that in a triangle the length of the sum of any two sides must be greater than the third side, and the equality occurs only it's a degenerate triangle. Anyway, let's not worry about it. So clearly, that's what is meant by clearly. But now let me write it that clearly in analytical language, okay, so that next step will be easy for us. So now let us look at the triangle inequality. So first we must look at rho 2 xy. Okay, what is rho 2 xy? I will now write it in the language in which we are familiar with. I equal to 1 to 2 xi minus yi squared to the power of, I will write it like that. I equal to 1 to 2 summation xi minus yi squared to the power of 2 to the power of half. Okay. Now, let me write this as summation I equal to 1 to 2 mod xi minus zi plus zi minus yi squared to the power of half. I can write like that? Yes or no? Now what do you get out of that? Minkowski. Call this as alpha I and that as beta I. Mod alpha I plus beta I whole squared, square root. I should write as, okay. Here also, what is this? Okay, root. So, says summation alpha I plus beta I squared is less than or equal to summation alpha I squared square root plus summation beta I squared squared. So, this is less than or equal to summation I equal to 1 to 2 alpha I squared to the power of half plus summation I equal to 1 to 2 beta I squared to the power of half by Minkowski. See, this is a loaded proof in the sense Minkowski is very general. So that can be now lifted to many cases. Now, what does that say? Therefore, the left hand side was rho 2 xy, and this is precisely by definition rho 2 xz, and that is rho 2 zy. And this is precisely what the triangle inequality is. Okay. So now you see the Minkowski's inequality is loaded with generalizations. First of all, I can replace the square root by a p. Okay, so now, therefore, okay, hence, okay, let me write. Hence, rho 2 is a metric on R2 and R2 rho 2 is a metric. Okay, this metric is called the usual, rho 2 is called the usual metric, whatever that usual means. Usual, you have been cheated very long on this, therefore, usual metric on order. Similarly, this is 4, example 5. Similarly, for p greater than or equal to 1, we can define rho p xy as equal to summation I equal to 1 to 2 mod xi minus yi to the power of p to the power of 1 over p, and this will be because again Minkowski, and again verify triangular inequality. Triangular inequality using Minkowski. And therefore, rho p is a metric on 2 and R2 rho p is a metric. Now, you see as metric spaces, they are different. Here we will see they are different, but they are same, all kinds of nonsense we will say later. That is what is known as the finite dimensional fiasco. Okay. But anyway, at the moment, at least they look geometrically totally different now, the distance calculation. We will look at it a little later in more detail what these distances mean. But right now, we will look at the metric spaces. We will not see any other implications of this definition at the moment. Right. So now, immediately we realize this key can be done even if I have n components, not necessarily 2 components, and also complex components, not necessarily real components. So, in general, we can generalize this as, what shall I call, example 6. We can further generalize this. So, let x be Rn or Cn and p greater than or equal to 1, define rho p xy is equal to summation I equal to 1 to n mod xi minus yi to the power of p to the power of 1 over p. Again, the other two axioms of metric are very easy to verify. It is always the triangle inequality which creates problem. Again, use Minkowski to get triangle inequality. See, that's the next example. Therefore, Rn rho p Cn P are metric spaces for any positive integer n and for any p greater than or equal to 1. Okay. Is that clear? Right. So now we are going to give one more example. I mean, there will be several more examples. The same Rn, okay. Let me probably the notation at the end I will say. Now, let us look at Rn or Cn and do it in some other way. So, let us consider x to be equal to Rn or Cn, any one of them, both the same arguments. Now, what I do is, if I take two points here, x will have x1, x2, xn, y will have y1, y2, yn. I look at the differences. In other words, each component is a real number or a complex number. I look at the distance between each component, right? Because each component is real or distance. So, I look at the distance between the usual distance between each component and take the maximum. What does that mean? Okay, so we define for xy in x, rho of xy, rho infinity of xy, this is the notation, as the maximum 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to n of xi minus 1. Okay. So, in other words, there are two discrete signals x1, x2, xn and y1, y2, yn, and I look at the variation at each time point, at the n time points, and I look at the maximum variation. And that is a measure of how these two fellows differ from each other. Okay, now it is definitely non-negative, definitely symmetric, and the triangle inequality follows from the triangle inequality of this. It holds for this, and therefore, if we take the maximum, it will hold. Okay, so that is what is this clearly. Clearly, rho infinity is a metric on x, and so R n rho infinity. Infinity, Cn rho infinity or metric spaces. So, now we have taken care of this p greater than or equal to 1, it is also infinite value is allowed. So, now these metric spaces we are going to give a name, one notation. Notation. Rn rho p, so n integer, positive integer, 1 less than or equal to p less than or equal to infinity, because now I am allowing rho infinity also according to that notation, okay, is denoted by Lpnr. Let us explain what all this means. This p denotes which metric I am using, this n, how many components I am dealing with, and this r denotes that the components are all real, and that little l is in honor of Lebesgue, French mathematician Lebesgue. And why little l, not capital L? Because something bigger, something more sophisticated like this will be called capital Lp. And similarly, C n rho p will be denoted by again Lebesgue, p metric, n components, components are components. And if the context is very clear what components we are using, I may not even write R and C, I will simply write Lpn and leave it at that. The context will tell whether I am telling R or C. So, that is the So, we started with one component real, then we moved to 2, then we moved to general n, then from R we went to complex n, so all that. The next stage will be to move to infinite number of components. Okay. So, that is the next example, where was I, 7, 8. Oh, okay, let me, I will come to this infinite things for a while. For a moment, let me look at a few more finite things. Okay. Suppose I take x to be the set of all binary strings of n. Okay. So that means, so x is the collection of all binary words of length n, collection of all binary strings of length n. let me put a capital. So what is x? X is the collection of all x equal to x1, x2, xn, where all these xi's are 0 or 1. How many are there? How many such? 2 to the power n. Each component has two choices. There are n, so 2 into 2 into 2 into 2, 2 to the power of n such strings are there. Now consider the set of all such binary strings and then now define h x y to be, I will write it as like this, this is simply the L1 distance, right, p equal to 1. Take the p equal to 1 distance, a mod xi minus yi to the power of p, that is 1, to the power of 1 or p, that is 1. So, there is the p distance between these two fellows. So, inside Rn, I am taking a smaller set collection of points, namely those points who have coordinates either 0 or 1. Now, calculate the L1 distance. What will be that exact L1 distance? The places exactly where the coordinates disagree. Okay. So, this is actually equal to the number of coordinates of x that differ from that of y. What is this called? This is what is called the Hamming distance. Okay. Okay. So, this is a matrix. This is the Hamming matrix. This is a metric on x. So, this is actually L1 metric. Hamming metric is an L1 metric applied to a subset of Rn called the Hamming . So that is a metric space now. And such metrics are the ones that are used in error correcting codes and so on. So, say that again. Yeah, but then the question is how much they differ. If you are allowing that that difference to be the same. If it is 3 and 0 also, the distance is only 1, and 3 and 1 also the distance is the same as 1, then there will be a little bit of confusion in the correction of the codes. Okay. So, the problem here is the difference will be either 1 or 0, but of course, I am not saying that this is the only metric on this. I can do again put to the power of p to the power of 1 over p, that is another metric. Okay, Hamming is not the only clever fellow. There are many, many metrics on this. For example, let me make up one general comment. Suppose you have a metric space. Inside that, you could take a subset and use the same metric here. That becomes a metric space. So, these strings are sitting in Rn. Use any one of the metrics you have in Rn here, that is a metric. Okay. So, that is not a problem at all. Okay. But Hamming used this particular metric because it was convenient for him. Each one of these was introduced for certain convenience at some stage. Okay, so let me make that remark. Okay. So, remark, let X row be any metric space so that Y be a subset of X. Then non-empty. Then rho is also a metric on Y, because the properties are satisfied globally, and therefore they are going to satisfy it even in those places in Y. Okay. So they are automatically, rho is a metric on Y, and Y rho is a metric space. This is called a subspace of the original metric space. Called a subspace of the metric space X. So what is Hamming space? Is only a subspace of L1n. Whatever. So, it takes all only some special sets here and uses the same L1 metric and that becomes the Hamming metric. You could have chosen any other and used that. Okay. For example, if you had used the L infinity metric on this, what would have happened is any two distinct points will be at the distance 1 and same points will have distance 0 and that will be the discrete metric. Two distinct points will be 1, otherwise it is 0, that will become the discrete metric. But that will not give you a clue as to how many places the changes have taken place. Okay. Now let me give you some crazy examples. Okay. Not very crazy, but these are somewhat more for the discrete math fellows, not for real analysts. Okay. The analysts on that side, Rn, Ln, then go to infinite component, then functions and all these things. I'll start with some very simple example. Okay. So let me take So this is just to say that you probably if you are very clever, you can use clever metric spaces even in discrete math. Let us take 3 points, any 3 elements. I am not even saying they are not points in space or plane or anything, just 3 arbitrary elements. That is my set. Okay. Now I am going to define a metric as follows. Metric on X. Of course, I have to define the distance between a point and itself as 0. So that is the first thing that I have to. I am going to explicitly say what rho does. Rho has to tell what is its value for any x, y, a, b. Okay. Now there are 3 choices for x and 3 choices for y. So totally 9 points at which I must define rho. So 3 points are already finished. Okay. Now next I will say what is the distance between rho a and b. I will say it is 1. But then I need symmetry. So therefore, that has to be rho of BA also. I have to define rho of BA also as 1. Then I will define rho of AC as 2. And I have to define to be of CA also. And finally, I will define rho of BC to be 3. And which should be the same as rho. That completely defines rho. All possible pairs, I said what the distance is. Now we have to only verify what the distance that it satisfies all the. Let us look at just simply by pictorially, rather peculiar picture. Think of these as 3 points. Think of this, they are not. Think of them as 3 points. Now the distance between A, B is 1. The distance between A, C is 2. The distance between BC is 3. Can you, in the plane, can you have such a triangle? No, because the sum of any two sides must be strictly greater than the third side. Okay. But it is a very peculiar distance which makes such a thing is possible. Suppose I just take these 3 points in the plane and define a new distance, then that triangle has a very peculiar this thing, but this length is different from the length that this theorem that the sum of the lengths of any two sides greater than the third side is valid only with that usual distance, not necessarily with this distance. Okay. No, it is like this. Suppose airline company is running flights from A to B, A to B, between any three of these points it runs. Okay. So nobody should say it by taking a circuitous route and saving money. And that's what triangle inequality is. By circuitous route, you may be paying the exact money as you travel direct, or should be paying more money. That's what triangle inequality is. So you, now you will see all that. Instead of, suppose I want to go from A to C, A to B, if I had taken a circuitous route, I will pay more money. That is amount charged. This is 1 lakh, that is 2 lakh, 3 lakhs. But if I had, this fellow wants to go from B to C, if he had taken that route, he would still pay 3 rupees. So therefore, now you will see that triangle inequality is automatically satisfied. There is nothing. They are living in some very abstract space. Okay, I have just illustrated it by drawing a picture. And illustrated it by thinking that it is an airline and a point to point. So in any abstract space, you can have triangles where Euclid is false. Okay. So Euclid geometry, though ruled for 2000 years, it is finally, as Bertrand Russell plays, Euclid. The universe of geometry is huge. There are several geometries, and Euclid was shown his place in a corner. Okay, that's Bertrand Russell, for some reason, hated Euclid. Every opportunity he got, he criticized Euclid. Okay, so let's not get to those controversies. Now, let me make this a little bit better example. I want you to go and look at the web. One of the simplest metro systems that is available is in the city of Rome. Very simple. Okay. So I will just look at that metro system now. Okay. It is a very beautiful system. This is the city of Rome. There is a metro that runs like this. Basically, from northwest to southeast, barring a little bit of, and there are number of metro stations here. A dot there. And it's called line A. Okay. And there is another line like this called line B. Okay, there are again number of stations like this, metro station, and these two lines meet only at here. Okay, and that is called the famous Rome termini. This is the terminus for all railways, European railways, bus stations, anything. It's a majestic bus station. Okay, if you have seen. Now it is deserted, but so that's the metro. Simple two lines. Not that they are not made a mess like what Bangalore are doing. Okay, and though it's a very old city, very very old city, and they have all kinds of buses running here, connecting this. So anywhere you can get down and go to the nearest place, take a bus and go to another place. Okay, it's a beautiful thing to run, go into these trains. But of course, let me warn you. You should be very careful. If you are careless for a nanosecond, you will lose your purse, you will lose your credit card, you will lose your passport, practically even your shirt and a coat, if you are careless. They are extremely smart guys. They will loot you like anything, in this, particularly in this room. But that's not what I am interested in. Okay, I am not going to metrize their looting capacity. But so, now what we will do is, let us take the set of all these metro stations as our x. Okay, so let x be the set of all metro stations. Okay. Now, I am going to define a metric on that. Suppose I have station 1 and station 2, I am going to define the metric, the distance between station 1 and station 2 as follows. It is likely that both are in the same route, both the stations same line, or one of the stations in line A and the another station is in line B. So, I will define rho of S1, S2 is the usual metro distance, metro line distance, if they are in the same route or same line, I will call it same line means line A or line B. Okay, suppose for example, there is a station here and you are going from here to here, that will be the distance, natural thing, you are not going to change your train. But if S1 and S2 are different lines, suppose I want to go from here to here, I will go to this terminus and change over. Okay. So, I will have to take the distance from here to the terminus plus there to there. Let me call this as the point T, terminus. So, it is the distance from S1 to T plus T if on different routes, different lines. Now, obviously, I have already defined this. Now, S1 and T are in the same line, T and S2 are on the same line. That has been defined in the previous step, they are in the same line. So, now that distance is defined to be this. That is the metro distance. And obviously, clearly, that follows all the triangle inequality, positivity equal to 0, if and only if they are both the same stations. And the distance from S1 to S2 is the same as the distance from S2 to S1 and so on. This is a metric on, okay. So, rho is a metric on x. So, x rho. So, the metro stations form a metric space with this metric. Now, we put a suit instead of actual distance, you can put suitable fare structure as calculating the distance between those two points. Again, the same story will continue. Okay, so now generalize this, therefore, is further, if you can further generalize this, suppose you have a city and there is a main terminus, and instead of just two lines, there are several metro lines going from one central, radiating away from one central court. Like if you go to Majestic bus terminus, there are a number of buses, one going to Shivaji Nagar, one going to Vijayanagar, etc. So, that's our this thing. And the same type of metric can be used with each station. Okay. If the distance between two stations is the normal distance, if they are on the same line, otherwise you go to the terminus and then go to that point, and that change over distance is the distance. Okay. The same distance as before, so I'll just general metric, general metro. Okay. Same distance. So, these are some very discrete cases where you can apply such trick ideas. And, the manner in which these fellows are, is any important place in Rome, you can take a train, go and then take a bus. And most of the places are walking distances from the metro, and if you are a little bit tired, you take a bus, 3 or 4 stops you can reach it. It is most one of the most amazing metros, and for Paris is even better, but that is little bit little too big was anything in anything that the French want to do, want to be big. Rome is very simple: one northeast, northwest to southeast; the other one is southwest to the northeast. Just an X, and that there the story ends. Okay, I have to see the metro. I still not understood the metro of Bangalore because I see only pillars. I have to still see the tracks. Afterwards, probably I will give that example. Okay, so now we're going to give one more example. Okay. Not one more, several more examples. I'm going to give. The next example is this. Yes. Now you'll see that every one of them is has been used, will be useful, and is being used in some place or the other in analysis. Okay, so these are all very standard examples. Let me now take x to be all the numbers. Real numbers between 0 and 2 pi, 2 pi excluded. So, what is this? This is the set of all real numbers such that 0 less than or equal to x less than 2 pi. Okay. Now, this is a subset of the real line. So the moment I have a subset of a big metric space, the big space R had the usual metric, the distance mod x minus y. I can use it here. So that will become a metric space. But now I'm going to give you a different metric. So okay, the usual metric on R, the usual metric on R, namely rho xy equal to mod x minus y, is also a metric on x by our remark above. What I wrote a remark earlier. Okay, I wrote that if we have a metric space and a subset y, and that is also a metric on the subset. So, but now we look at a different metric on this. So let's look at, look at another metric. Okay. So suppose now x and y. So here is my 0 and 2 points. Suppose x and y are 2 points there. This may be x, that may be y, that this may be y, that may be x. So, what is the usual distance? Mod x minus y. But now, how big this can be? At most 2 pi. Will it hit 2 pi? It will not hit 2 pi. Anything will be as close to 2 pi but never hit 2 pi. So, but now look at therefore 2 pi minus this. This is also positive. There are two, take the minimum of these two. And that I will call as my new distance. Calculate mod x minus y. Calculate 2 pi minus mod x minus y. For example, let's make this clear. So, for example, if x equal to pi by 2 and y equal to pi by 4, then mod x minus y is pi by 4. 2 pi minus mod x minus y is 7 pi by 4, right? So, what is the minimum of this? The minimum of these 2 pi by 4, that is what is defined as the distance. On the other hand, if x is pi by 4 and y is 7 pi by 4, right, then what is mod x minus y? It is 6 pi by 4, and 2 pi minus mod x minus y is pi by 2, which is the minimum norm, pi by 2. So, rho of pi by 4 and 7 pi by 4 is defined as pi by 2. Is that clear? So, therefore, you take mod x minus y and take 2 pi minus mod x minus y, compare them, whichever is minimum, that is taken to be as a distance. Now, we say, why this concocted distance, very peculiar distance? Okay. Now, this distance is not very peculiar, it is a very simple geometric distance. Okay. Consider the unit circle in the plane. I had a teacher by name Prof. Venkat Selengar. You should tell me, if you go to math, if you go as a mathematics teacher, first thing you should learn is to draw a good circle. It was not because you will be teaching geometry all the time, but because you will have to give zero many times to many students. So, I have never learnt, because I am very liberal, I never give a zero. Now, take the unit circle, okay. Now, corresponding to every x in the 0 to pi, we find a point on the circle. What is that point? Simply take the point which has this angle x. So, that point is the one that corresponds to x. Now, as x goes around 0 to 2 pi, all these points are covered. So, this correspondence, so therefore, x goes to the point, every point x in 0 to pi is identified with the point cos x sin x on the unit circle. This is a unique identification. Now, if you have x and if you have a y, that is identified like that. Now, this distance is this like traveling along circle. Now, why that minimum? You can take this distance or this distance. So, you have to take the smallest arc. So, the distance between these two points identified on the unit circle along the smallest arc joining these two points. So, look at this as ring roads. Okay, and these, of course, in our ring road there may be a one way, a bund, a procession, but free flow ring ways, you always take the shortest arc to reach the point. Okay, so that is the distance. So that geometric idea gives us a distance way on the numbers between 0 and 2 pi. Is that okay? Right. So that's another example of a metric. So I'm restrict myself. I'm so far restricting myself to R1, R2, Rn, finite number of points like this. I have not lifted to infinite case. So, one more example I will give you, namely the following. What is this number? Example what? 13? Let us consider the set X. First of all, I will start with a simple example so that we will see explicitly things nicely, then we can generalize this. The set of all two by two real matrices. Okay, I am just taking all two by two real matrices. So X for me is like A11, A12, A21, A22, where the Aij's are real. So, I am going to look at the collection of all 2 by 2 matrices. Okay. take any matrix A in X. Say A equal to A11, A12, A21, A22. How many entries are there? There are 4 entries. So I could as well form a vector with 4 components this way. Okay, first write the first column, below that write the second column. So a matrix in a sense can be thought of as a vector in R4. 2 by 2 matrix can be thought of as a vector in R4. The moment I have R4, I have all the matrix in R4. All that I can use this. Okay, so let me make that comment clearly. How many times clearly I use and how many times I am really clear, I am not very clear. Clearly, any such matrix can be thought of as an element A11, A21, A12, A22 of R4, and therefore can invoke all matrix of R4 to define matrix on. Okay. But now let me look at some more things that I can do with that. I really do not know whether I can do all of them, but at the moment, okay. Let me just. So now, but we will look at something else now. So take such an A. So therefore, there is no question that there are matrix on the matrix. The matrix collection, there are matrix. Okay. The word metric is different from the word matrix. Okay. So we have to be very careful. On the matrices, we are defining matrix. But now I am going to define another metric on the matrix. Take any such A, I have A11, A12, A21, A22. I take the row, first row, okay, and take the sum of the absolute values of each entry. So I calculate mod A11 plus mod A12. I will call it the first row sum. This is called the row sum. Take the sum of the entries in the row with an absolute value. Similarly, the row sum 2 is the entries in the second row. So, how many row sums I got? 2. Okay. Now, define the distance between any two matrices. Okay, let me even make another notation. So I define NA to be the maximum of these two row sums. Okay, take the maximum of these two row sums. Okay, so for every matrix, there is something called the maximum row sum. Maximum row sum. By row sum, we mean the sum of absolute values in a row. So, for each row, you take the absolute value sum and among all the row sums, take the maximum. Okay. Now, we define for M n in x row mn. The notation is pretty bad. There is okay, row m, what shall I use? Cd. Any two matrices, C and D, I define the distance as first find C minus D and then find the n of this. Find the difference matrix, find the row sums of the difference matrix, find the maximum row sum of the difference matrix, and that is what is the matrix. So, this is going to be a metric. You can verify the properties. Is that a metric? First of all, is it non-negative? Certainly, it is maximum of non-negative quantities. So, it is non-negative. So, let us say C minus D is this. Okay, I have called it as A1A. So, it is certainly non-negative, non-negative, maximum of non-negative things. So, it is non-negative. If that is 0, that means both R1 and R2 must be 0. If R1 is 0, these two are 0. R2 is 0, these two are 0. So, the matrix is 0. So, it is equal to 0 if and only if the matrix, the two matrices are equal. And the only thing you have to verify is triangle inequality. So, everything involves only absolute values. So, you should be able to use the absolute value triangle inequality cleverly and get this thing. Okay. These are all used in convergence analysis of iterative processes involving matrices. Okay. So, now let me see whether I will start with more. Yeah. Similarly, okay. Remark. Yes. Similarly, we can work with columns. What I say, see, you, whenever you want to do convergence analysis of iterative processes, you need some measure of error, okay, and these things come in, these distances come into the picture. Okay. Thought of defining one more metric on the matrices, but probably I would need some property of real numbers to be used. So, at the moment I will not do that. Maybe sometimes later I will review some properties of real numbers as we go along, so that we can do that. So, now the next step is, see, almost everything that we have seen is, it in a sense, finite sets or finite dimensional spaces. We have not moved to the infinite situations. Okay. The next step is to move to infinite dimensional spaces. Okay. This is a very vague statement, because in a matter where there is no notion of a dimension, but what we mean is the examples we had are vector spaces and they were all finite dimensional. We will look at vector spaces which are infinite dimensional spaces. Now, remember we had spaces like this LPNR and LPNC. Now, corresponding to this, now we will remove the restriction on number of coordinates. We will take infinite number of coordinates, we will have LPR and LPC, we will define what all these mean. Okay. And in most cases, it is up to 1 less than or equal to P less than infinity, it is the Minkowski again and again that will come into the picture to give us the triangle inequality. But we will look at all these things. But now, let me begin with some functions. Okay. For that, I suppose everybody is familiar with continuous functions. Okay. Minimum that everybody should know is about continuous functions. Now, maybe I will, what is a continuous function? Let us let us make things clear. Suppose I have the interval 0, 1 or a, b, and I have a function which is real valued. What is meant by saying that the function is continuous in that interval? The continuous function. Any idea that you have, any definition that comes to your mind? See, I know that all kinds of definitions will come, okay, and many of them look very concocted, and the ones that are not concocted are not correct. I remember that in my earliest days, one of the teachers in the college said, very easy to know what is a continuous function. You can draw the function without lifting the pencil. What is wrong with that definition? What's wrong with that definition? You can draw, you should be able to draw the graph of the function without lifting the pencil. Is there anything wrong in that definition? Looks okay, right? No, I am talking about only in the interval. No, I am not talking about higher dimension, nothing, that interval A, B, 2, 1. What is wrong with that definition? Let us say, is it again? It looks like correct, right? Looks like correct, is different from correct. Let us say, that I can go from here to there. I can go from here to there means what? I must move, right? I must start moving, it's dynamics. The moment dynamics comes into the picture, I must know in which direction I should move. Should I move like this, or what? So I have the value of the function at a equal to this. Now the pencil has to draw. The pencil has to move, you should know in which direction it has to move. That means you should know the tangent to that curve. If it knows the tangent, that means you are also assuming that the function is differentiable. The derivative is what gives the function. But there are continuous functions which are not differentiable, so that falls. Okay, drawing the curve without lifting the pencil doesn't make sense. It already assumed that the function is differentiable. Okay, so therefore, we have to be very careful with. So let us assume that all of you know, and that if you do not know, don't tell that you do not know. Go and look up what the definition of a continuous function is. But what I want you to know, look at, is some properties of continuous. First of all, suppose I have a closed interval, say 0, 1, 10, 15, any finite closed interval, and you have a function which is continuous in that interval. What all can you say about that function? Yes? See, I talk so loud, it should be bounded. That is one of the things people say, okay? So, f continuous on this finite interval closed, then f must be bounded. Anything else? Limit, that is the definition. Okay, go back. So, limit x tending to x naught, fx equal to fx naught for every x in that interval. That is a definition, one of the definitions of continuity. Okay. Anything else? Okay, let me ask you the following question. Conduct an examination. Okay. The examination is for 100 marks. That means the marks code is bounded. Does it mean that anybody will score 100? Somebody would have scored 100. The bound would not have been attained. So, what exactly you want to refine that statement? These are all called hand waving proofs. There are many proofs in maths. One is proof by logic. The other one is proof by hand waving. Okay. And that's more. And the most, the other one more proof is proof by intuition. This is not true. Don't you see it? That the others will just not bother to open their mouth because maybe I am making a fool of myself. So that's proof by intimidation. But now, what is a very fine point of this? That is the first theorem, optimization. There is a maximum and a minimum. This is the first theorem on optimization, that a continuous function on a closed finite interval will have a maximum and will have a minimum. That is, there is a point at which the value dominates all other values, and there is a point at which the value is dominated by all other values. So, the first optimization theorem is that a continuous function has a maximum and a minimum. And if you have a continuous function and replace the value at each point by the absolute value, then you get mod fx. Will that be continuous? That is also going to be continuous. And mod fx being continuous will have its maximum and minimum, right? So, if you have a continuous function, there is a point x naught on this closed finite interval. There is a point x naught at which mod fx naught, the value, will dominate all other mod fx's. That is the point that we will use. So, okay, so next time I will probably list some of the properties of continuous functions which may be useful for our next few things that we are going to do. So, I will list all the properties of continuous functions. And we will try to see them in the general context also a little later, when instead of interval I have a metric space, and see what happens. Okay. So, our next set of examples will be these spaces and function spaces, and these are going to be the ones that are going to be more and more useful for us when you are analyzing a signal or when you are analyzing a solution of a differential equation. They are all going to be in the space of some collection of functions. And therefore, these function spaces will play a crucial role in all our analysis. So, my next set of examples will be there. Okay, I think we'll stop here. This is right time.